very resourceful.
This stands for, the question was, article always on the positive side of the path, negative side of the path, both sides of the path, or we know that we don't know.
We have 4 points.
Like, we're confident that we just don't know. It's not like we just don't know, we actually know that we don't know. Okay, that makes sense.
What if that was an actual answer on the AP test?
WPTWDK.
Know that we don't know.
As opposed to, like, one answer would be, we don't know. And then the next one would be, we actually know that we don't know.
There's no way for us.
And then the third answer is, we don't have any hope of ever knowing. That was the most popular response. All right, here we go with that. So, okay, just a quick practice on this one. Let me get a couple of angles here. So this is a velocity graph. With respect to time again. Remember to practice units, so we'll do feet per second. Okay, a couple of quick questions for some extra credit points. This is velocity. Based on this graph, please show me your vote. Is the particle always moving right, always left, both, or you actually just don't have any idea? Or no, that's the wrong thing. This actually is, I've got to fix that now. We've established the new acronym. So, number four really is, that graph does not contain enough information to answer the question. Therefore, we are confident that we know that we don't know. So, show me your vote. What show me? Yes, exactly. Show me, hey. What's your vote? Come on, please. What's the question? The question is, this is a graph of velocity. Based on this graph of velocity, is the particle always going to the right, always to the left, going both directions at some, you know, is it going back and forth? Or is it that graph doesn't tell you? You can't determine us. Show me. Give yourself three. So because they don't talk, when I talk. Don't talk when I talk. So because the velocity is both positive and negative, the particle is going both directions. Okay, look at this one now. Okay, the particle travels along this path we talked about. Does this graph provide enough information to determine that the particle is always on the positive half of the path? So it's the particle's moving back and forth, but it's always moving over here on the positive side. It doesn't ever pass, so this, what's the name of this location called, zero? Origin. So it never passes the origin, it's just always over here. Or would you vote that the particle is actually always on the negative half of the plane? Is it moving to both halves? Or is this actually based on that graph? There really is no way to know. Show me your vote. So Bryson, share with me your reasoning for why you know that it's both halves.
Because positive and negative. No, you know where I start. You know.
Perfect.
I don't know.
You're okay.
But yeah, we know that we call it.
No worries, no worries. Yeah, let me just act it out. Three for Bryson, listen. Three for Bryson. The particle could have started, look at me, come on, don't talk. The particle could have started here in the negative portion of the plane. Just stand up loud, please. Which way does the particle go first?
Right.
Again?
No? Right.
So it moves to the right some amount. Then it's going to go back to the left some amount. Then back to the right side. But it could have stayed just on the negative side. But it all depends on where the particle starts. So we clear on that? Show me two of them makes perfect sense, one of them doesn't. Seems like hiding it under a color, I can't see. Okay, two more points, okay. So the correct answer is here, right? Show me if you have this. Who had this? Who had this? 4 points. Good. Okay. As I said, the fundamental theorem really is the most important equation as far as if you're prioritizing things to know. So I want to make sure you're using the fundamental theorem to answer these questions. So I want you to do this on your paper. Let's say that they tell you that the position of the particle at time equal 5 is, I don't know, random number, negative 3. So the position of the particle at time equal 5 is negative 3. We're being asked to find the position of the particle at time 1. Okay? So what I want you to do right now is write a fundamental, remember the fundamental theorem isn't a formula, it's an equation that you manipulate. So write a fundamental theorem equation that says this, x of 1 equals, and so this half of the equation's gotta have x of 5 as well as an appropriate integral, and adding or subtracting as appropriate. So figure out what goes here. Feel free to work together on that one. Raise your hand if that's written on the paper. Show me the next one. I got a look, so. 2 points to be for Jacob. Kind of wave at me if you want me to show more detail where that came from. Okay. Next step. Look at me. Come on, look up. Last time I talked about how when we have this integral, if we look over here, we say that integral starts, let's see, 1, it goes all the way to 5. Okay? And last time I would have had you break this integral, show me on your hand, how many integrals? Show me. How many integrals would I have you break it into? showing 3, marked out 3.
We would have done an integral over here from 1 to 2. We would do a different integral from 2 to 3. And then the third integral would have been from 3 to 5.
Questions? Should be 1 or 2 if it makes perfect sense. 2 is perfect, 1 is not. Left down 2 more. Okay, here's a nice, most of us would prefer to write less than more, it's human nature. So here's something you can do now. Don't forget that you can break this into separate intervals. But it gets to be a bit of writing to write out the interval into 3 chunks. So from this point forward, there will be problems in the future. We'll want to split it still. But from this day forward, you can do the splitting in your head when possible. Once in a while, you'll need to split it on paper. But most of the time, you can split it in your head. And literally say, okay, so we've got x of 1. X of 5 was given to us as being negative 3. Here's a huge caution, though. I see subtract, so I write it down. But I know this is going to become 3 separate computations. So, heads up, you know what else I must write here if I'm going to avoid a mistake. So whenever you have subtract, and then it's going to end up with separate things over here after the subtract sign, you've got to write something, or you'll end up making a mistake. I didn't do that. Important. So I put a parenthesis. I say V of t dt, let's see, looks like 1.5 for a change in time of 1 second. So 1.5, okay, another thing, look, units are critical. Like, you've got to mentally verify that the units are working. You don't have to write them all down as you're working the problem. That can be a bit cumbersome. So I've got 1.5 feet per second. Multiplying by seconds, yeah, that gives me feet, that's what I want, because I'm looking for a position. So you can leave off the units right there. So this is 1 plus, next time interval, it's going to be negative 4, multiplied by a change in time of 1, plus the last time interval is a positive 3, change in time of 2. So here's positive 3. Okay, good check is to say the integral's got to go for 4 seconds. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. It's all consistent. Questions? Please look.
Is that not 1.5 times 2?
This one here.
Oh,
question.
You're starting at 1.
Right.
Oh, okay.
See that?
Okay.
No worries. Yeah, so the velocity was 1.5 for a full 2 seconds. But to answer this question, we're only using that portion. 2 points. Anyone else want to talk? Go here. Okay, next thing. Look at me. As much as possible, don't use a calculator on this. They've gotten a little bit more, how would you say, challenging in recent years, where they're giving more and more computations in the non-calculator section that aren't really hard, but if you haven't kind of just practiced a little bit, it can be a little bit tough during the test. So as much as you can, don't use a calculator unless I tell you this is specifically a calculator problem. So just do the math. So you got negative 3. You guys do it, I'm lazy. Don't do the work. Thank you.
discussion. All those who are participating in the assembly, as far as doing performances, could you please make your way down to the field house? Thank you.
Make sure you watch the video.
Are you performing?
Yeah. Hey, heads up. Who's got the answer? Show me that. Come on, show me that. We have this. All right, two more points. Any question? Okay, next thing. Okay, look at the graph. Think about what the graph is depicting and answer this question. So this is the first question we worked on. Now we're going to do a second. So answer this question. What's the total distance traveled t equal 0 to, we'll do the full interval this time, t equals 6. Actually, change my mind, sorry. Let's do the same as that one, it'll be a better comparison. So we'll go 1 to 5 again. Okay. Figure that out, please. Okay, make sure you either watch the videos, come back to the class. Do this, please. Find the total distance traveled. Just use your logic. Figure out total distance traveled between time 1 and time 5. We know that when we're trying to draw this out, the particle traveling along an x-axis, where's the origin of that path? The particle we found out began its journey at negative 6.5. So over here, this is where the particle is located when it starts. So here's time equals 0. Particle moves to the right.
Isn't that time equals 1?
Yeah. Oh, sorry. I was just, oh, that's, I'm having a hard day. Apparently it's time for a break. So time equal 1, here's where the particle is. It moves to the right, 1.5. Maybe about that much. That's time equal 2. Particle then goes to the left. So it heads back this direction. Goes a distance of 4 that direction. So this location right here, location negative 5. Over here, negative 9. This is time three. Then the particle comes back to the right, a distance of 6. Travel should have been 11.5. These
administration edit, this is on your paper, show me that.
Oh, wow, that was rough.
That's what I was on the thing I was watching, actually.
Oh, watching is good. Sorry, talk to Rich. So, look at this, please. I said that the particle started here at time equal one. Location given to us was, when we figured it out, was -6.5. I looked up here and said, hey, for that first second, velocity is 1.5 for 1 second. So it's moving to the right, 1.5. So 1.5 times 1 would be 1.5. So it moves to the right, 1.5. Therefore, the distance traveled was 1.5, the new location is -5. So we wanted to see if that makes perfect sense.
That makes sense.
Yeah, gotcha.
So you found change in position versus distance traveled. No worries. Be careful with that, though. This is one of the favorite things to ask on a task, is sometimes ask for change in position, sometimes ask for position, sometimes ask for total distance traveled.
And I understand how you do it.
No worries. So anyone want to talk about this? Cool. Do one more just to make sure we got it. So let's go down a little bit. This time I'll not talk, sorry. Find the total distance. This time, so just as a comparison, look at the board, please. Hey, look up. Just as a comparison, between time 1 and time 5, the change in position is actually positive 3.5. The total distance traveled is much greater, 11.5, because the particle is going back and forth. So if you have a question on the difference between total distance versus change in position. Okay, answer this one, please. Total distance traveled from time equals 0 to time equals 6. This time I won't talk, sorry about that. Go. If you're done, keep going for a minute. Raise your hand if this is written on your paper, please. Show me that. What is this written down? 16. Sorry, that's pencil.
16. About 8.
How many points do you have right now?
32.
60, oh my God.
29.
We'll give you half, 8. So, so when we're trying to find the total distance that the particle travels, we don't want to keep track of whether the particle goes left or right. We just want to keep track of how far. So we don't want to count it as a negative, otherwise it would give us the false impression that it traveled less than it has. Super awesome. Are we good? Okay, do this one now, please, as a comparison. So question 4 here. Find a change in position. Time equals 0 to time equals 6. Go. So find the total change in position from time 0 to time 6. Now the negative is important because we do want to keep track of the actual position of the particle. Vision, if you're done, please. Maybe about 1 more minute. Change in position. As soon as they ask you to find change in position, you've got a thing, fundamental theorem. So, hands up, what formula should I write to calculate this answer? What's the formula? Still got only half the room. I've talked to somebody who has their hand raised, so you know, so you get the points as well. What's the formula that I should be writing to find the change in position? The equation is very important. It's on the quiz today, so hands up. Who knows? Come on.
Yeah.
What's the equation look like?
Integral f.
Type 3 first.
Yeah. So
0 to 6.
Yeah.
0 to 6. And pause just 1 second. Point from loop. You have there go, B, because we're integrating velocity. Okay. Keep going, Luke.
Then x is 6.
We knew this before we said it. Okay, point. Okay, look at this expression. Okay, right here. Look at this. Question, Julie.
So,
with
integrals, are we always just going to be dealing with the position of the velocity? We're not going to be doing anything.
outstanding question. Three for Julia. Listen, we're starting with philosophy because it's something that's familiar, easy to talk about, easy to kind of act out in the room. But no, we'll use integrals for all kinds of things. It's just where we're starting. So, good question. Okay, look at this, please. Hey, this little expression. You have to have it memorized very, very well. For example, please raise your hand if you can tell me what's 7 times 6. Hands. What's 7 times 6? 42. Okay. Hands up if you have 42. Come on, show me.
Points.
The result of that multiplication was 1.5 times 2 is 3, which tells us that during this time period, the particle will move to the right 3 feet, and 1 or 2 makes perfect sense. Two more. Okay. Jacob, back up. Jacob, back up. Jacob, back up. Jacob, come back. Jacob, come back. Okay, you good? Listen close. Hey, crucial here. What other mathematical computation is occurring that has nothing to do with velocity and particles and movement? When you take 1.5, just raise your hand, 1.5 and you multiply by 2 and you get 3. That's it. Mathematical computation related to what you are looking at, like just geometric. What geometric computation is occurring? It's an easy question. I'm not trying to fool you. What geometric computation is it, Emily?
Area.
I'm going to do that. Come on, show me. Point. Okay, so back to Julia's question. So far, we've used integration to talk about finding change in a particle's position, talk about finding the actual position of a particle, and talk about how to find total distance traveled by a particle. You can throw away the particle for a minute. This is just out of that. You can also use integration to compute areas. Okay, now, again, I'm giving you something super simple. You don't need an integral to say 1.5 times 2. Where it will become useful is when you are asked to find the integral of something like this. Hold on. Which we'll practice after the break. So, if you end up with something like, say, that, and you're asked to find, say, this area, right there, okay? We'll practice using integrals to find this area. But don't make the mistake that some make. They learn in other classes. They have teachers who will tell them, oh, integration means area. No. It's like saying addition means adding up apples. Do you use addition just to add apples? No, you use addition to add up. Yeah, you're an orchard maker. Thanks, but I got an orchard maker. Okay. thoughts of the four. Stupidest things to say ever. And one girl, one year, she was so nice, Rochelle Curtis, she sat about right where Alex is. And every time I'd say something just dumb like that, she'd smart it down. And then she gave me a book at the end of the year. Nine pages of her mom. I was actually really touched. I really was. Because she was super nice about it. Like, oh my gosh, I said all of this. What's that?
What was the title of the
book? It was just, no, just like calculus, you know, and then she gave me here, you know. Or something like, and then she actually was kind, she had a couple of pages like, you know, like inspirational thoughts, you know, in your class, like whatever. So it was really nice. Hey, look. Keep that straight. You can use integration to find area. But here's a problem. Go back here. Okay, this was pretty straightforward. When we integrated here, we took negative 4 times 1, negative 4 times 1 is negative 4. So the integral didn't actually give us really the area. Negative 4 isn't the area, 4 is the area. Question? Okay, so we have to do something to fix that. Now, my guess would be that you would all say, hey, why don't I just do absolute value here? Show me your hands if that's what you're thinking. Come on, show them, be honest. So you're like, I was thinking that I was dreaming of Christmas or something. I'm sure you have a point for raising your hand, thank you. Hey, look, listen close. That does work, but it's not the best way to do it, okay? So I'm gonna give you one more formula, I want you to write it down. And okay, I found something very interesting. Students I have who take my advice and memorize formulas as you are learning them, I mean, you get it memorized kind of today. You don't wait for the test. You don't keep using your cheat sheet as you are practicing and doing homework. But you get it memorized today. They perform far better than the ones who keep waiting.
Like, it's killing people because they just don't get stuff memorized and they try to cram it in the night before the test and they always perform low. So get it memorized right away. Total distance traveled, change of position, fundamental theorem. Here's the formula for computing area. You can find the area between two functions. So this is the area between F and G. You can find the area between F and G by integrating over whatever, you know, space you're integrating for. And you always take the topmost function, subtract the bottommost function. So this is not a formula you're going to see in a math book, but it is an extremely useful formula. We won't do absolute value. That works, but it's just not the easiest, best, most universal method. This way is better. So we have to figure out which function's on top, which one's on bottom. Okay? And so if g is on top, you're going to take g of x minus f of x. If f is on top, you'll take f minus g. If they go back and forth, you do two integrals. Question? Okay. Quick joke before the bell rings. So this idea of finding an area always reminds me of a funny thing that happened at home. So several years ago, when my youngest son, who's now 20, he was about 09, like fourth grade, his older sister was taking calculus in high school. And she asked me for some help on something like this, right? So I was kind of helping her understand how to find this area. Her little brother, smart little guy, he's kind of listening, you know, seeing what Caleb's doing, his little fourth grade homework. He hears us talking about area, he gets super excited, like little kids will. He's like, I know, I can help. I'm like, there, go ahead, tell us what to do. He's like, area, it's easy, watch me. He gets out some graph paper like this. And he says, look, it's really cool. If you have a shape like this, and you need to find the area, just draw it on some graph paper. Just count up the squares. 47, all right. Got it? He's like super excited. Jamie, I can help you, says his older sister. I says, I can help you. Good job, Derek. It's really smart. He says, here's the problem Jamie's dealing with. So I drew this. He looks at it, and like he's sitting there just stared at it like I'm in there. We just waited. What do you think, Derek? He's like, how do you find this area here? He's like, you don't. Okay, listen, no homework, listen, hey, no homework tonight. But again, quiz on Tuesday. And again, make sure you're focused on the big ideas. Make sure you're focused on the big ideas. After the break, transition to back to actual AP problems. Of course, it was great about
you.
Yeah, which of course they don't ever ring on time. So
that's
going to
be
awesome.
Yeah.
I didn't say that.
Have we permitted this bathroom?
Yes. Wait for the bell, please.
And the idea is that, back to the idea of what we mean by higher limits, in the limiting sense, you make the width of the rectangle infinitesimally wide. So it has width, but it doesn't have width. You know what I mean?
I remember last year, it was during Paul's break, my friend invited me.
I need to turn the rest of my extra credit and get a test crash.
So if I check the
test corrections already?
Do I get like points for that?
Yeah, you do. Did I check them off?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. So we're just typing them in.
So I got like 6 problems left. Okay. I could finish that. And like, what's it? With the assembly, like, when should I?
If you want to come finish during the assembly, that's okay.
Okay, that would be perfect.
So if you want to go check in with your second period teacher.
Yeah, that's also good.
And then just
come back.
Hurry back fast because I have to go to the assembly.
Okay.
But I'll, you can be here. It's fine.
Okay, and then on my yellow quiz thing, we put it in, but it's not in Skyward.
Oh, it's okay. Hold on a second. I remember us doing it. We probably got somebody distracted. Mm-hmm.
So I just like stick this here or something?
Because you're coming back out.
Yeah, okay.
That's fine. Hold on. Everybody stay put. Yeah.
So I get 4 other points on this?
So you get 4 points, test points for doing the corrections.
Okay.
They just go in the test category,
yeah,
so,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
So it all adds up to the
yeah.
same. Okay, so 4 points for the corrections.
Can you please come to the attendance office?
I have 13 right here.
13 more tickets. And an extra pebble. Okay, so we'll give you one more here for the pebble. So that'll be 5. Something just went
there.
Wrong. Hold on a second. That doesn't make sense. Hold on. Why did we do that? Oh, I put it in the wrong column, sorry. I'll figure out this day.
Full on
13 more would be 46 total. There you go. Good
job. Thank you.
You're welcome. Mm-hmm. Remember the number you had right on that one?
32.
No, you have those both there. Actually, maybe a higher score than that. So something's mixed up on something. No. So, like, right here is. Oh, wait a minute. I'm mixed up. So I was on the wrong one. So 32. My bad. So.
Okay, sweet, thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll be right back.
All right.